and I would be happy if he wanted to write to me with those, and I would be able to give him a fuller answer on the specific patient cases.
Thank you. We now move to First Minister's questions. Question number one, Kezia Dugdale.
To ask the First Minister what engagements she has planned for the rest of the day.
First Minister.
Later today, I will have discussions to take forward our plans to host, at the invitation of the United Nations, an initiative to help prepare Syrian women for peace building. On that note, Presiding Officer, I'm sure we're all mindful that British service personnel, many of them based at Lossiemouth, are now in action over Syria. Notwithstanding my opposition to this action, my thoughts and my good wishes are very much with them at this time. However, I remain deeply troubled by the decision of the UK government to take the country into conflict with no strategy, no exit plan, and against the wishes of the overwhelming majority of Scotland's MPs.
Like the First Minister, I did not support extending airstrikes into Syria. However, with British forces now involved, we must come together to support the brave men and women in our armed forces. I'm sure the First Minister will join with me in extending the support of this Parliament to them. Of significance in the papers this week, Presiding Officer, it's climate change. And this week, the First Minister announced that she would be attending the climate summit in Paris. And I'm sure, like me, she looked at David Cameron's appearance there with a mixture of bemusement and anger. The Prime Minister told delegates that the Earth was in peril and that there would be no excuses for this generation of politicians if they don't act. But this is the Prime Minister who undermined the renewable industry by slashing subsidies, the Prime Minister who has promoted fracking, and just last week the Tory government broke a manifesto promise by cancelling their £1 billion carbon capture and storage competition. So does the First Minister agree with me that this posturing from the Prime Minister in Paris was sheer hypocrisy?
First Minister.
Here's something we may not hear too often in the Chamber, Presiding Officer. Yes, I do agree with that 100%. World leaders meet in Paris over the course of this week and indeed next week, to hopefully come to an agreement that will help the world better tackle climate change, I think it is incumbent on all of us, and that includes the Scottish Government, to make sure that our policies and our practices, what we do ourselves at home, is commensurate with the rhetoric we use about climate change. I will be very proud to represent Scotland on Monday in Paris, where I will take the message from Scotland about what we are doing and use that, I hope, as a motivation and a spur to others to follow suit. I absolutely deplore some of the decisions that are being taken by the UK government, decisions that undermine our efforts to increase generation from renewable energy, and the decision that I commented on in this chamber last week to cancel the carbon capture competition, which, as well as being, I think, damaging to our efforts to reduce emissions and tackle climate change, is also deeply damaging to our reputation amongst the business community. We had two FTSE 100 companies entering this competition in good faith, devoting time, effort and resource to it. And I think it is nothing short of a disgrace that it has been cancelled at the last minute.
Councillor Dugdale.
I'm glad the First Minister agrees with me, but she's going to Paris, in her own words, to show that our world-leading targets set the benchmark that the international community needs to match. Presiding Officer, this Parliament unanimously set those targets in 2009. So when the First Minister tells the international community she has the most ambitious targets in the world, will she remember to tell them that she hasn't hit those targets once?
First Minister.
I would encourage Kezia Dugdale to study in some detail all of the facts and information around this. In particular, I would encourage her, this is important, I hope we can continue to come together as one on this important global issue. But when we set the target for 2013 back in 2010, the reduction in carbon that we anticipated at that time was 31.7%. That was the target that we anticipated we would have to reduce emissions by. In actual fact, what we have achieved is 38.4% from the 1990 baseline. The only reason why that means that we still haven't met the target is because of the increases to that baseline. Fixed annual targets were missed because of improvements to the way the data is calculated, which added 10.6 megatons to the 1990 baseline. And that is equivalent to almost all of the emissions from waste management, public sector buildings and the residential sector in 2013. So we've actually exceeded the reduction that we anticipated, but because of the increase in the baseline, that means we haven't met the target. Now, I would have thought...
Order!
This is actually factual information
exactly.
I'm sharing like with the Chamber. And the opposition.
Order.
Now, if we are serious about the rhetoric that is used, the rhetoric, the very welcome rhetoric Kezia Dugdale has just used, then we should do two things. We should celebrate the progress we are making in Scotland and use that to encourage others to make similar progress, but we should also not rest on our laurels. We should be determined to continue to make progress. And it might be appropriate, Presiding Officer, just to end with a quote from Professor Jim Ski, who is the UK Committee on Climate Change, a comment he made back in the summer of this year. If you divide where Scotland is now versus where it was in 1990, it is actually among the world leaders. That is unambiguous.
Okay, so Dugdale. Ms. Dugdale.
There's more spin in that answer than your average wind turbine. The fact is that the First Minister's government has never hit a climate change target. And on Monday, we saw one reason why. The report on public sector climate change duties was published. And yet again, the Scottish government missed their own target to cut emissions from their own activities. And no wonder. This report shows that the government's use of vehicles, taxis and private cars all actually increased in the last year. So if our own government can't hit their targets, how can she lecture the rest of the world on their duty to do the same?
First Minister.
Yeah, I really think Labour should raise its game if it wants to raise issues of
order.
Global.
First Minister.
What I've just narrated to the Chamber is factual information about the performance of Scotland. Something I think when it has been praised by the UK Committee on Climate Change, when we have people like Desmond Tutu and the head of the UN climate body saying in a letter to the Environment Minister in August of this year, Scotland's ambition to create a strong and healthy renewable sector and a low carbon economy is a shining example of the measures that can be taken to diversify energy supplies, attain energy security and attract investments. When people across the world are saying that about Scotland, why is it that Scottish Labour are the only ones still trying to talk down the achievements of our country? So what I will do,
Order, First
Presiding
Minister.
Officer, is I will go to Paris on behalf of the people of this country. I will encourage others to follow the lead that is recognised as being set by Scotland. But here at home, I will also make sure that we continue to challenge ourselves. The progress that I have outlined to the Chamber shows that we have actually exceeded the reduction in emissions that we set back in 2010. But because we know the whole world, not just Scotland, needs to go further, we will continue to raise our sights and raise our ambitions. Because raising our sights and raising our ambitions for Scotland is what characterises this government, and it puts us in stark contrast to the opposition.
Kezia Dugdale. Ms. Dugdale.
Let's see if the First Minister is raising her game on climate change, because she's about to get control over a key environmental tax, air passenger duty. And what is her plan for this green tax? She wants to abolish it. And the government's own figures show that abolishing APD will increase emissions by 50,000 tonnes a year. To put that in context, Presiding Officer, the First Minister could fly to Paris and back every day for 200 years and do less damage to the environment. So the First Minister heads to Paris next week, head of a government that has missed its own targets 4 years in a row, is unable to control their own emissions and plans to abolish environmental taxes. When it comes to hypocrisy and climate change, isn't the First Minister giving the Prime Minister a run for his money?
First Minister.
Well, firstly, I won't be flying to Paris on Sunday. I'll be taking the train to Paris on Sunday.
First Minister. First Minister.
Secondly, Presiding Officer, Kezia Dugdale's arguments around APD as it relates to the environment might have more force if the revenue from APD was actually hypothecated to spend on reducing emissions. It's not. It's simply a revenue-raising measure for the UK government. And, of course, the reason why, and some of us were last night at the annual dinner of the Scottish Chambers of Commerce speaking to a wide range of business people there who are focused on trying to internationalise the Scottish economy, grow the export base of the Scottish economy. And I suspect there was a fairly considerable consensus that reducing APD is an important measure to create jobs, improve our transport links and help our business community grow their exports. So we'll continue to make sure, Presiding Officer, that as a government we are pursuing policies that help promote equality and social justice, that help promote our environment, but also help to make sure that we have a vibrant, growing economy. It's that kind of balanced approach to governing this country that means the SNP is standing here and Labour are sitting over there.
Question number two, Ruth Davidson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'd like to add my gratitude to the brave service personnel who will be involved in this necessary military action in Syria. As too often before, their selfless efforts abroad do all ensure and help to keep us living safely at home. So can I ask the First Minister when she will next meet the Secretary of State for Scotland?
First Minister.
I have no plans in the near future.
Ruth Davidson.
Thank you. Presiding Officer, the SNP's policy of free university education is failing poorer students. A new report by Universities UK today shows that poorer students in Scotland are only half as likely to go to university than those across the rest of the UK, and that the gap is getting wider. Yep. 5 weeks ago, I raised this issue with the First Minister, suggesting that a graduate contribution could help restore bursary funding that has been gutted by this SNP government. These are bursaries which support poor students who otherwise couldn't get a foot through the door. When this SNP government came to office, bursary support stood at £104 million per year. Can she tell me what the figure will be next year?
First Minister.
We will continue to make sure that we have a funding support package for our students that supports students, particularly those from the poorest backgrounds, to go to college and to university. But I actually cannot believe, Presiding Officer, that Ruth Davidson has come to this chamber today and raised the issue of bursaries with this government. Because doesn't she remember that George Osborne of the Conservative Party, which the last time I looked was the same party Ruth Davidson is a member of, stood up in the House of Commons last week to deliver his autumn spending statement and announced that the UK government are going to abolish all bursary support for students from April next year. Not reduce it, not to take it back a little bit, but abolish it completely. Abolish it for student nurses as well as for students in general. Yeah. So I'll take no lectures whatsoever when it comes to student support from the Conservative Party or from Ruth Davidson. But let me just give Ruth Davidson, just as I did Kezia Dugdale, a few facts that might get in the way of her rhetoric, but she'd do well to listen to them. The number of people from our most deprived communities achieving a university qualification has increased under this government by 24%. The number of 18-year-olds from our most deprived areas applying to university is up by 50%. Young people from our most deprived areas are more likely now to participate in higher education by the age of 30 than they were in 2006. And of course, although the UCAS figures have to be treated with caution because they underestimate Scotland's performance, they nevertheless show that Scotland is reducing the attainment gap at university faster than any other part of the UK. Those are the facts, and what will certainly not help us make any further progress, Presiding Officer, is if we were to go down the road of the Tories by taking away bursaries from all students.
Ruth Davidson.
Presiding Officer, I asked for a number. It was a number that the First Minister didn't want to give.
Order.
And the thing is...
Let's hear Miss Davidson. Order.
She didn't want to give the number 5 weeks ago either. So after that session, we put in a Freedom of Information request to the Student Awards Agency of Scotland, who tell us that bursary funding will be around £60 million in 2016, which is a drop of £40 million under this government. The SNP says that their no tuition fee policy is designed to help poorer students gain access. This week, a report from experts at Edinburgh University said, despite political rhetoric surrounding free higher education in Scotland, the system has failed to produce more egalitarian outcomes compared to the rest of the UK. The Scottish Government's policies, they added, were, and I'll quote exactly again, reproducing existing social inequalities. So the SNP have slashed college places. They've cut bursaries, and the policy that's supposed to counter all of this does not work. I know the First Minister will want to dismiss me, like she's done before, but these experts are telling her that a contribution after graduation can be used to help poorer students into universities in the first place. Will she dismiss them too?
First Minister.
Well, I am not going to dismiss Ruth Davidson, but I am going to criticise, as I believe people across the country will do so, her shame-faced hypocrisy on this particular issue. Because the reality, Presiding Officer, is this: whatever the SNP government is spending on student bursaries is going to be more than the zero the Conservatives are going to be spending on student bursaries when they scrap them for all students next year. So we will continue to make sure that we give our students a decent funding package. Average support for students in Scotland is now the highest that it has ever been, at £5,610 per student, up nearly 5% since the year before. We remain committed to bursaries for the poorest students, unlike the Conservatives, who are scrapping them from next year. Our minimum income guarantee for undergraduate students from the poorest households living at home is the highest package of support anywhere in the UK. Now, that is the reality, and that is part of the reason why we are starting to make the progress I cited in my earlier answer in increasing the numbers from our deprived communities going to university. So we will continue to do that work, and we will continue to do that work while also protecting a principle, Presiding Officer, that I hold dear, which is free access to education based on your ability to learn, not on your ability to pay. And let me just end by quoting what the NUS had to say about the report that Ruth Davidson cites. The idea that abolishing free education, a clear recognition of the public and social good provided by higher education, would improve fair access seems bizarre. It is bizarre, Presiding Officer. The NUS are right, and the Tories, not for the first time, are downright wrong.
This is the question. David Torrance.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The First Minister will be aware that the structural safety checks on the Fourth Road Bridge are causing major disruptions to commuters from my constituency. Can I ask the First Minister what discussions have there been with Transport Scotland and ScotRail to mitigate these disruptions?
First Minister.
The Transport Scotland Resilience Room has been operational since the defect on the southbound carriageway was identified. Officials are working with our roads operator, Amy, to identify the problem, and traffic management measures are now in place. The decision to close the southbound carriageway, Presiding Officer, was not taken lightly because we understand the disruption to commuters that this will cause. But it was taken for the right reasons, for safety reasons. Measures to reopen it or reopen it partially will be taken as soon as it is safe to do so. And I hope that assurance is welcome in the Chamber. And finally, I just take the opportunity to thank the travelling public for the patience they're showing at this time.
Question number three, Rob Gibson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the First Minister what part Scotland can play in the international mitigation of climate change.
First Minister.
Well, Scotland is supporting international efforts to secure an ambitious and legally binding climate treaty at the UN conference. Both I and the Environment Minister will be in Paris over the next few days to promote the action that Scotland is taking, action which has been praised as, and I quote, a shining example by the head of the UN climate body. Indeed, Scotland is now three quarters of the way to achieving our world-leading emissions reduction target. We are producing half of our electricity demand from renewables already. We have delivered our target for community and local renewables 5 years early, and we've met our energy consumption target 7 years early. We're also benefiting from 45,000 low-carbon and environmental services jobs. So I think, Presiding Officer, Scotland does offer both a message and a model for climate action that we will be proud to promote at these vital Paris talks.
Rob Gibson.
I thank the First Minister for that answer. This week, the Herald described the record of the UK government as particularly shameful, with retrograde measures such as the ending of subsidies for onshore wind. Does the First Minister agree that climate justice must start at home and that climate justice must be a rallying point for all parties and all sections of the public to each act quickly to decrease our greenhouse gas emissions, but vitally in terms of climate justice, to give home insulation and onshore wind power development the top priority?
First Minister.
Yes, I do agree with that. At home, it's important that we take continued action, and all of us take continued action if we are to achieve our emissions reductions. That's why we've designated improving energy efficiency as a national infrastructure priority, and Scotland has, as I've already said, made significant progress in renewable electricity, with around half of our gross electricity consumption now coming from renewables. But, of course, we do share the renewable sector's concerns that the damaging and premature cuts to support for renewable energy being driven through by the UK government will hamper future progress. But when we talk about climate justice, of course it's important to concentrate on what we do at home, but it's also important to concentrate on the contribution we can make to climate justice around the world. And that's why I am proud that Scotland is showing the way by putting people and human rights at the heart of our action on climate change. We've supported 11 projects through our Climate Justice Fund in Malawi, Rwanda, Tanzania and Zambia, which helps some of the world's poorest and most vulnerable people, particularly women and children, adapt to the impact of climate change. So both at home and overseas, Presiding Officer, I think Scotland should be proud of its record, and it should use that record as a way of encouraging others to do more as well.
Question 4, Nigel Don.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the First Minister what the impact on Scotland will be of the recent defence review.
First Minister.
Scotland has been disproportionately hit by previous strategic defence reviews, which resulted in the closure of bases and the creation of major capability gaps. I wrote to the Prime Minister this week seeking assurances for Scotland about the latest review. While we welcome plans to locate 9 maritime patrol aircraft at RAF Lossiemouth, we're also mindful that some previous commitments have never materialised. And of course, the review creates new uncertainties for shipbuilders on the Clyde, with only 8 out of the 13 Type 26 frigate orders that were promised having been confirmed. Overall, the review does little to reverse the disproportionate decline in Scotland's defence footprint over more than a decade. And most indefensibly, it proposes wasting an estimated £167 billion on Trident at a time when people are being so hard hit by the Treasury's damaging austerity cuts.
Nigel Don.
I gather from that response the First Minister already shares my concerns about the balance of what the UK government is up to. Does the First Minister feel that there is any prospect at all that the UK government might rebalance to conventional forces which might actually protect us rather than preserving this sacred cow called Trident?
First Minister.
Well, of course, in this chamber, Trident is now only supported by the Conservatives and Jackie Bailey, an unholy alliance if ever we saw one. I do share the concerns that have been expressed. I think it is important that we see a balanced defence. The National Security Strategy, which accompanied the defence review, set out a range of threats, all of which we should take very, very seriously. But to not one of these threats is Trident a sensible answer. So I agree that instead of investing in Trident, we should be encouraging the UK government to make sure we've got the right conventional forces in place that are commensurate with the risks we face as a country.
Annabel Goldie.
I'm glad, Presiding Officer, the First Minister acknowledges the long-term future of the Lossiemouth Air Base is being secured as a consequence of the Strategic Defence and Security Review. And given her opening remarks this morning, does she also welcome that the review underlines the UK Government's commitment to spend 2% of GDP on defence, meeting our NATO commitments and ensuring that British forces remain some of the best equipped in the world?
First Minister.
Well, We have seen disproportionate cuts to our conventional defences in Scotland, and while of course I welcome anything that secures the future of Lossiemouth, I think it's also important to point out that the only reason there has been any threat to or question mark over Lossiemouth is due to decisions taken or proposed by the UK government. So I will continue to argue we do face, and this day of course is a very, very timely reminder of this, we face a range of threats, Presiding Officer, which is why I think it is right that we continue to argue for conventional defence forces with the right capabilities and to oppose spending so much money on nuclear weapons that do not provide a defence to any of the threats we face as a country.
Question number five, John Pentland.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the First Minister whether the Scottish Government has requested an extension of the 45-day consultation period for Tata Steel plants at Dalzell and Clydebridge.
First Minister.
Well, we've discussed the length of the consultation period with both Tata and with workforce representatives. The minimum statutory period is due to end tomorrow, but consultation between Tata Steel and the trade unions is still ongoing, and that, of course, is primarily a matter for the company and the unions. The focus of our activity, Presiding Officer, remains very firmly on securing an alternative commercial operator for DL and Clydebridge. And as a member of the task force, Mr Pentland will know that Tata Steel has confirmed that there are currently serious parties potentially interested in the plants. This is encouraging, and we continue to do everything we can to assist that process. I'm sure everybody across the chamber will recognise, and I've said this previously, there are no quick fixes here. There are certainly no easy fixes. But together with the workforce, the unions and with others, we are working tirelessly, leaving no stone unturned in our efforts to keep these plants open.
John Pentland.
Can I thank the First Minister? Clearly, workers are very stressed and worried about their future. Does the First Minister agree that we have the potential to create a centre of excellence for steelmaking in Scotland? And can she reassure me that in that quest to achieve that, leaving no stone unturned, that the Scottish Government is prepared to provide support for any transitional period leading to a buyer taking over or public ownership that may be necessary to save the jobs at DL and Clydebridge, which I trust the Scottish Government values as highly as those at Creswick?
First Minister.
Well, I think the member knows how highly we value the jobs and the continuation of the steel industry in Scotland. I do very much agree with them that I think there is a real opportunity here to create a centre of excellence in the steel industry in Scotland. So when I say we will leave no stone unturned, I mean exactly that. If there is any viable option that will secure the future of these plants, then the government will explore taking that forward. And there have been, as Mr Pentland will be aware, suggestions made at the task force about support that could be provided in a transitional period, and the Scottish Government is exploring all of these options. But I would repeat what I said in my initial answer. We do right now have serious parties that are expressing potential interest in the plants. I think it's therefore appropriate and therefore right that we concentrate on doing everything we can to see one of those expressions of interest turn into something real and viable, and that at the moment is where the Scottish Government will continue to expend our energy.
Claire Adams.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Is the First Minister able to give an update on the work being done to possibly reduce fuel and business rate costs at the Tata plants in Motherwell and Cambuslang?
Minister.
Well, we have been working very intensively to create the best business environment for any new operator that might be prepared to take on the sites. As a result of work that was commissioned by the Business Minister, we know now that energy costs at the sites could be cut significantly and that there's potential for renewable electricity generation and sale of heat from the plants. And we also continue to maintain pressure on the European Commission to accelerate state aid clearance for the Energy Intensive Industries Compensation Package and to do that before Christmas. On business rates, we've also agreed with the Lanarkshire Assessor that he will take into account the state of the steel industry for the next business rates revaluation, while we are also open to options for reducing the rates liability as long as those options comply with state aid rules. So as well as doing everything we can to secure a commercial operator for these plants, we will also continue to do everything we can to reduce the running costs, which of course make these plants even more attractive to any commercial operator.
Question six, Murdo Fraser.
Thank you. To ask the First Minister what the Scottish Government is doing to reduce healthcare inequality.
First Minister.
There's been a general improvement in many health outcomes in recent years. For example, a reduction in premature mortality for under 75s. We have a range of public health policies on tobacco, alcohol, diet, for example, to improve health and to close the equality gap. One of the ways that the Scottish Government is tackling health inequalities is by reforming the GP contract to reduce bureaucracy and give GPs more time to devote to the complex problems their patients can face, particularly in areas where patients face the greatest inequalities and health issues. Further changes will be made to the 2017 contract, including reviewing the Scottish allocation formula, and this will ensure GP surgeries in the areas of most need receive proportionate funding to the needs in their areas.
Murdo Fraser.
Can I thank the First Minister for her response? She mentioned GP funding. You should be aware that earlier this week, a report from Professor Graham Watt of Glasgow University highlighted that GPs in the most deprived areas of the country received £10 less per patient than those in wealthier areas. Professor Watt has stated that we have the worst health inequalities of any country in Western Europe, and this is one of the reasons behind it. In my own region, every GP practice in Kirkcaldy is operating with a full list and cannot take on any new patients. What can the Scottish Government do more than it is currently doing to combat these inequalities?
First Minister.
Well, firstly, I would say I welcome Professor Watt's findings, and we will take them fully into account in delivering a new GP contract for 2017 and accompanying revised allocation formula. Interestingly, though, Professor Watt's study examined data from 2011-12. I've looked at the recent data for GP payments for 2014-15, and what they show is that the most deprived practices received on average £7.65 more per patient than practices in the most affluent areas in 2014-15. So I hope that is a sign of some progress in the direction that I suspect Murdo Fraser wants us to go in. Of course, the allocations formula has been in place since 2004. It has undergone some revisions and some changes since then, but the new GP contract, which we're in the early stages of negotiation, which will take effect in 2017, gives us a good opportunity to revise that allocations formula to make sure that it is reflecting the varying needs of GP practices in different local communities, and I look forward to having the support of the Chamber as we seek to do that.
Malcolm Chisholm.
Does the First Minister agree that over and above fundamental action to create a more equal society is necessary to support targeted action with the most vulnerable individuals and the most disadvantaged communities? Initiatives such as the Royal College of Nursing's Innovative Nursing at the Edge initiative, which will actually be featured in a meeting of the cross-party group on mental health in Committee Room 2 in 5 minutes' time.
After the advert, First Minister.
I better not take too long answering that question or I'll make you late for the meeting. But yes, I do agree with that, and send my best wishes to the RCN in the meeting they're having and support the work that Malcolm Chisholm has referred to. But, you know, generally in terms of his question, I do agree with that, and I would also refer him to the support that we show to the deep end GP practices, which are very much about recognising the particular needs in our most deprived communities. And we've got to make sure that as well as raising the health outcomes of our country generally, we are taking the action that will close the gap as well.
Thank you. That ends for Minister's questions. We are now moving to members' business. Members who live in the chamber should do so quickly and quietly.